risen.
He is risen indeed.
That was okay. That was fine. Thanks, Ray. I appreciate it. Let's stand and let's get started this morning. Oh, Ray, can you actually pause it on Spotify? I think it's still playing up here. It's a groovy song, man. I really like it. There we go. Very groovy. All right, let's worship this morning. Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. And see what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero, oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We're dancing your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Yeah! You've been faithful. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things. I know you'll do it again. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. Oh, you will. Every captive, you break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We're dancing your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Hallelujah, and hallelujah, God, above it all, and hallelujah, God, unshakable, and hallelujah, you have done great things, yeah. Sing hallelujah, God, above it all, and hallelujah, God, unshakable, done great things. Yes, you have. Yes, you have. We sing hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. And hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive. Chain, oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things. Amen. You can have a seat.
All right. Good morning, everybody. I want to welcome you to Anchor Church. So glad that you're with us this morning. He is risen. He is risen. We could do a little bit better than that. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He has. And we just want to welcome you to this Resurrection Sunday here at Anchor Church. Really glad that you're here with us this morning. If you're watching online, we're really glad that you're here as well. Don't be a stranger. If you're visiting, if you're new here, just a couple things for you to know. One is we have coffee in the back, so please feel free to help yourself at any point. Our restrooms are down this hallway, and on the left, you'll see signs for that. And then we have a couple of QR codes in the pews in front of you. You don't have to engage with those, but if you want to, there's a way for you to check in to let us know that you are here today. We would love just to say hey and thank you for coming. We don't spam you or use your information in bad ways, but we'd love to know that you are here. Also, there are links just for our digital announcements and for giving if Anchor is your church home. So those are ways you can engage with us. All those links are also available on our website, anchorbuffalo.com. Just a little bit about us, our church, we planted here in North Buffalo about 7 years ago, and our mission, the thing that we're after, is to be anchored in the hope of Christ, and then to express that hope in love, community, and service to others. And so we invite you to be a part of that and to journey with us, and it's amazing what God has done, and we have high hopes for what he wants to do this morning. So let me take a moment, and we'll pray, and then we'll continue on in our service this morning. Let's go to him. God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for a new day. Your word says that your mercies are new every morning. And so however it is we got here, or however it is we are watching online, we believe that that's true for today. That we can experience your grace and mercy in a new way today. And so, Lord, we invite you here. We pray, God, that you would help us to see you clearly, to understand who you are, and your intent for us, your desire for us to know you, and not just to know you, but to walk with you and to have eternal life with you. And so, Lord, be with us now. We thank you. We pray all of this in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Well, why don't we stand up? We'll continue on in our worship, okay?
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone.
We sing, oh praise the name.
Oh praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord, oh Lord our God. Of dawn, the Son of Heaven, he rose again, and all trampled death.
Come on,
where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. The name
you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for me, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Majesty. Sing majesty, Lord of all, let every throne before him fall, the King of kings, oh come adore, our God who reigns life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing of dying.
him fall, the King of Kings. Oh, come adore our God who reigns forevermore. Sing in majesty, Lord of all. Let every throne before him fall. The King of Kings, oh, come adore. There was a moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life, the darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners, for every curse his blood atoned. When final breath and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared?
All hail,
all hail, King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world. Oh, we hail you. We lift your name today. There was a moment when the sky lit up, a flash of light breaking through. When all was lost, he crossed eternity.
I love this.
The King of Life was on the move, for in a dark, cold tomb, where our Lord was laid, oh, a miraculous breath,
come on,
and we're forever changed. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord. The Savior of the world. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All come on, forevermore. Majesty, Lord of all, let every throne before him fall. The King of kings, oh come adore our God who reigns forevermore. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world. Hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. You can have a seat. Well, I want to say good morning again and wish you a happy Easter. Just a reminder, if you've come in since the start of our service, I do want to let you know a couple things. We have an open table here at Anchor Church, which means at the end of the service, we're going to have communion together. And you don't have to be a member of our church to come up. And in fact, I'm going to invite even people, maybe you walked through the doors today and you weren't a follower of Jesus. Today might be the day that you say yes to him and again, can take part of our communion table. I do want to welcome you. My name is Steve. I'm the pastor here at Anchor Church. And I don't know about you, but it kind of feels good when you're kind of like having an argument or a debate or a heated discussion, as some would call it. Feels pretty good to get in the last word. I don't know. Well, let's step back for a second. How many of you guys kind of low-key enjoy arguments? How many kind of like it? Like, you avoid it, but once you're in it, you're there. Yeah? Yeah. I'm a peacemaker. I try to calm the waters, but if I were to be honest, there's something in me that once we get going, okay, once the argument takes place, once it's started, I kind of like it. And when I was a kid, when I was a teenager, more specifically, I remember growing up, and my mom and I wouldn't always see eye to eye, shocker, for those of you who have teenagers. I know that's a crazy thought. And I remember how badly my mom and I both fought to get the last word. And we'd be, you know, yelling at each other, and this and that would be going on. And, like, I would just have this moment of teenage brilliance. And I had just the zinger, right, just the thing to say. But the trick was, like, my mom also loved getting in the last word. And so this is a challenge because it just, these arguments would never end because we just kept on wanting to, like, get the last word in. And so then it became tricky because, like, you know, then you'd have to do things like, you know, at first you would, like, say the thing, like, well, I guess you don't really love me then, do you? And then you'd have to try to get out of the room as fast as you could before, like, the other person could reply back. You know what, blah, blah, blah. And I just, you know what I mean? And I remember oftentimes my mom's final word, which now hit a little different, but I remember often you'd be in the middle of these fights, and her last word was, I can't wait until you have children of your own. And I was like, whatever. And whatever. And then, but sure enough, Sure enough, I'm starting to realize there's this universal relationship between parents and their children. When it comes to who gets in the last word, it's still a problem. It'll always be a problem. It's true not only in families, in arguments with mothers. It's true in like Facebook debates, you know. Again, people like try to get in their zinger and like, and then they're like, I have nothing more to say, and then leave, you know. Which they don't really do that. They're invested. They're still watching. Okay, so anytime somebody comments on something, like I'm gonna just say this and then I'm gonna leave, you know, just reply back like your mama and see if they really left, because they didn't. Okay, they're gonna come back at you. It's also true, actually, in when it comes to negotiations and debates. Getting in the last word is pretty important, because in any negotiation or debate, really what it comes down to is framing, the framing of a conversation, the framing of a discussion. And oftentimes, the last word is a chance to put on one last frame that changes the discussion in your favor. And so often, again, in these things, it reminds me, actually, just a historical fact for y'all, because, you know, it's a special day, we should dig into history. There are these famous debates between Abraham Lincoln and his challenger for the Senate, Stephen A. Douglas, for this U.S. Senate seat. This was a couple years before Abraham Lincoln ran for president. And they had these series of three debates. And because getting in the last word is so powerful or so important, what they would do is they had, and this is quite a unique debate style, they would have a debate where the first person would have an hour to speak, an hour, 1 hour straight for them. If anybody would like to complain about how long I preach, they would speak for 1 hour nonstop. Then the other candidate would speak for an hour and a half nonstop, sharing their ideas. This is when people had ideas and had policies and plans to propose. Anyway, and then the first person who would get 30 minutes at the very end to kind of like rebuttal. And they did three debates and took turns who started first and who ended last. The last debate they had, though, Abraham Lincoln went first. But because he did such a good job in that hour and a half, or that hour that he had, and then the rebuttal, and then he did so well in framing the end of his argument that they credit that debate with his winning the presidency 2 years later. That's how powerful getting in the last word can be. And so we're here today because we want to talk about the last word. You see, here at Anchor, we've been going through the Lenten series, looking at the famous last words of Jesus, the words that he shared when he had been crucified and was on the cross. And it's been a powerful series for us as we look at these things that Jesus shared with his disciples and those, the crowds who were watching and jeering, and also us. And so we're going to be looking at the power of these last words, because this is what Jesus said. This is one of the last words he said on the cross. When Jesus had received this vinegar, this wine as a drink, he said, "It is finished." And then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What did he mean when he said it was finished? We talked about this last week, but I'll recap it a little bit. The first thing that he mentioned, or the first thing that was finished, was the completion of his mission. By saying it's finished, Jesus had declared that his mission on earth, the mission that was planned by God the Father, was accomplished. The mission included teaching and healing and ultimately offering himself up as a sacrifice for the sins of humanity. When he said it's finished, he also meant that he was fulfilling all the prophecies that had been told for hundreds of years before he came to earth. He fulfilled all of these Old Testament stories and prophecies. Isaiah 53:11 says this, "After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities." You see, when Jesus says it is finished, he's saying, I have done it. I've bared the iniquities of the world. I've bared the mistakes and the sins and the evil of this world. He completed all of these prophecies. And when he says it's finished, he meant that he had won victory over sin. Through his sacrificial death on the cross, Jesus accomplished the redemption of humanity from sin. So when he says it's finished, he's indicating that the debt of sin, which Scripture tells us the wages of sin, what we earn by living a selfish life, what we earn by going our own way and living as if God isn't God, the wages of that, the consequence of that, what we get in payment is death. And so when Jesus says it's finished, he's saying, I've paid this debt. This debt that I didn't earn on my own. Jesus lived a sinless life. He lived a righteous life before God and man. And so when he says it's finished, he's saying, I paid the debt. But here's the thing. He says it's finished. And he gives up his spirit. And that Good Friday, he's taken off the cross and he is dead. And he's laid in a tomb. And if we're going to be honest, and if we look at the story, if we look at how those closest to him reacted, Jesus got a last word in, but really it feels like death ultimately got the last word, because he did this great thing, he accomplished the mission, he fulfilled the prophecies, and yet he did not come off the cross in victory. Angels didn't come and rescue him. Everybody who was watching this scene said, death got the last word. That's life. That's something you and I all understand, because it often feels that. The silence of the grave is deafening in the world in which you and I live. Death is often seen as this ultimate end, a point of no return. It seems to bring a definitive silence, seems to close the chapter in someone's life. It feels like death gets the last word. And death is something that you and I all see around us, and we experience it. We've all had moments where, in the midst of losing someone close to us, it feels like death has gotten the last word. It feels like there's nothing we can do, that we are powerless to stop the way in which this world churns. No matter how much we try. And even when we wake up in the morning, after losing someone, we wake up in the morning and think maybe it was a dream. For a moment, for a split moment, we forget. And then the crashing of reality that, again, death has taken something we loved. For those who loved Jesus and followed him and watched him over the 3 years of his ministry, who shared meals with him, love that girl. She's a firecracker. Death seemed to have the last word. Death seemed to get his way. And death is a mystery to us, right? This unknown, we read about it. We have a lot of ideas about it. But it feels so final. And what we see in Scripture is this, though. This is what happens on Easter morning, Matthew 28, 1 through 10. After the Sabbath, after Saturday, the first day of the week was dawning. Mary Magdalene and other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised. As he said, come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee, and there you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers and sisters to go to Galilee. There they will see me." You see, Jesus does get the final word. And death does not. You see, Jesus, in his resurrection, reframes the human experience. Reframes what it means for you and I to be alive. He reframes what it means to be reconciled to God and to be a friend of God, to be a child of God, and to have a life that springs eternal. Jesus reframes it in his resurrection. He gets the last word. He gets not only victory over sin, but victory over death as well. You see, if you look at the story, the big story of the Bible, of all of these scriptures, all 66 books from Genesis to Revelation, what you see between the lines and in the background of everything that's going on, you see that there is this cosmic battle. There is this struggle going on. It starts with the fallen angels who rebel against God. And then we see that as they're cast out of heaven, there's a plan that's devised to ruin this creation that God has made. And so Satan tempts humanity to join him in living life apart from God, to doing things our own way, to not trusting our Creator. And from that moment on has been this battle, this struggle. And through it all, it seemed like death always got the last word. All through scriptures, we see God moving in the life of people, God revealing himself to humanity, God making a way for people to come to know him. And yet, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, King David, Moses, all of them died. All of them still went into a grave, and there they stayed. And there was this battle going on and God from the very start said, there's going to be a way. I am going to make a way to win this battle, to overcome evil, sin, and death. And so what we see in the empty tomb, what we see when we look at the resurrected Christ, is we see God's victory and his final word. Jesus' resurrection is not just a historical event, but a decisive victory in this cosmic battle. Revelation 1:18 says this, and this is Jesus speaking. He says, "I was dead, and see, I am alive forever and ever, and I have the keys of death and of Hades." You see, in the resurrection, Jesus takes power, takes control, and wins this battle. He has the last word over sin and death. 1 Corinthians 15:54 through 57 says this, "When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Death doesn't get the last word. Not at all. We have victory over death because Jesus' death and resurrection conquered that power. His words, "It is finished," marks the completion of his earthly work and the beginning of eternal life for all who trust him. That's 1 Corinthians again. And not only that, but we're given hope and assurance. Assurance of eternal life. Jesus' resurrection is a promise. He says, "I am the first, but not the last. I'm the first to be resurrected, but I won't be the only one. Those who trust in me will join me in this resurrected life." Romans 6:4 says this, "Therefore we were buried with him in baptism into death, so that, Just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we also might walk in the newness of life. Not only does Jesus rise from the dead to make a way for you and I to have life and eternal life with the Father, it's more than just about what's going to happen one day in the future, but also it marks the beginning of an age where you and I can experience true transformation through the power of God's Spirit. True transformation to live lives that are victorious. Because Jesus lives, we can live a new life characterized by victory over sin, freedom from fear, and the power to live according to God's purposes. This is what 2 Corinthians 5:17 says. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Look, new things have come into being. You see, we believe that not only does Jesus give us life in the future, but he said, I come to give you life and life to the full. Jesus' plan for us not only is for us to have a resurrected life with him for eternity, but actually to be transformed in the here and now, to have freedom here and now over sin. Reminds me of the a famous hymn writer named John Newton. You might know this story. If you do, that's fine. John Newton was born in 1725 in London, England. In his early life, he began getting involved in the slave trade. He was a captain of a slave ship. He led a life of moral recklessness, debauchery. He was known for his profanity, his heavy drinking, his involvement in this inhumane, brutal slave trade. But then something happened. In 1748, during a violent storm at sea, Newton experienced a transformation. You see, he was fearing for his life, which, by the way, all of us fear for our lives. In fact, that fear of death, the fear of losing our lives, drives us to do a lot of selfish things. But here he is on this ship out at sea. The waves are crashing. It looks like the storm is going to rip the ship apart. And at his weakest moment, at a moment where nothing else was working, he had a moment where he realized he could call out to God, and so he did. He cried out to God for God's mercy, to have mercy on him for his life and what he had done. Not necessarily for the ship sinking, though I think that certainly was on his mind as well. But what happened after he survived that incident was he became a man of faith. He recognized that Jesus was the only one who had power over death. He became convicted of his life. The Holy Spirit convicted him of the sin of slavery and his involvement in this trade. And so he moved away. He left the seafaring life. He transformed his life. He changed and became a vocal advocate against slavery. And his most famous contribution is the thing that maybe you know him by, was he began to write songs about his Lord. Most famous being Amazing Grace. Yes, a song that now has become well-loved in the church universal, but especially the black church, written by someone who was a part of the slave trade, who was transformed, not someday far off, but in the moment, in his very life, he was transformed by God to live and become more and more like Jesus and to live for him. You see, Jesus gets the final word. He gets the final word over sin, over death. And here's what may be most important for us today. He gets the final word on you and me. We get a lot of messages in this world about us, about what we have or don't have, what we look like or what we don't look like, the success that we have or don't have. There's a lot of messages out there that want to have a final word about you and me. There's a lot of things going on that would like to frame your life and mine, to frame it as success or failure, of having worth or not so much. And you and I, we can wrestle even ourselves. Maybe it's not from the outside, but inside, we can often have a word for ourselves, and it's not a kind one, of doubting our worth and value, doubting whether or not we matter, doubting whether or not we've been accomplished the things we were supposed to or not. But I have good news today. No matter what you've done, no matter what you've gone through, no matter what people have said about you, or the people who've turned their back on you or disappointed you, Jesus gets the final word. He gets the final word about you. He wins the prize. He's especially positioned because he was fully human and fully God. And because of his death on the cross and resurrection, he gets a word. He gets to say something about you. And while the enemy of our souls, he can throw all he wants at us. And if we were to stand before God and Satan could say all sorts of things about you. He could recount all the things that you've done wrong, all the selfish things, all the thoughts that you've had, and all the things that nobody else knows. He could love them all to shame you and make you seem like you are not worthy of anything and that you deserve death. But he doesn't get the last word. Jesus does. And Jesus' last word is this. In Revelation, Jesus said this. He said, "I stand at the door and I knock. And if you'll answer the door, if you'll open the door, I'll come in and I'll dine with you." Jesus' final word is one of invitation to say, "You can come to me. You can come to me with all that you are and all that you're not. You can come to me with all of your mistakes. You can come to me with all the shame and all the things that have been placed on you. You can come to me in your loneliness and despair and hurt. You can come to me with all that you are. Mask off. No more show. You can come to me. And if you'll open the door, I'm going to spend time with you because I love you." You see, Jesus' last word is one of love. His last word is one of hope, to say, if you'll trust me, if you'll turn from your life, if you'll turn from living things your way, if you'll turn towards me, the biblical word for that is repent. If you'll repent, if you'll just say, okay, my way doesn't work. I'm going to try to stop having the last word and framing it myself. It's not working. If you can do that and turn to Jesus and say, I want to follow you, and I want your death on the cross to pay for the penalty of my sins. I want to enter into that so that I can also have your life, as the scriptures say. You'll turn to Jesus. You'll open your heart to him and say yes. Jesus gets the last word. And his word for you is to say you're forgiven. All the mistakes, all the wrongdoings, all the burdens that you carry on your shoulders, I will take. And instead of that, I will give you my spirit that's going to help transform you in this life. And I'm going to give you life that will never perish, never go away, because I get the last word. So as we're going to be going into our time of communion, and I just want to invite you. Again, maybe you walked in the doors this morning and you wouldn't classify yourself as a Christian. Or maybe you grew up in the church and so you would. You check some boxes as you grew up. You hit some milestones in the church tradition. But you've never really actually made a conscious choice. You've never actually expressed a faith to say, I want to accept Jesus' offer. I want to receive forgiveness of my sins. And I want to follow after Jesus. I want to know God. I want God to be my friend. I want to be his child. I want to know that when I die, that it's not the end, but that there's this gift of eternal life that I can have. If you want to make that decision today, a couple things. One, I would invite you to come up to communion as well. We have a prayer team that would love to pray with you if you would like. But even if you don't, like, there's crosses here on the table. little wooden crosses. And if you want to say yes to Jesus today, not for those of you who are already believers and already following Jesus, but if this is kind of a decision you're making today, I would invite you just to take one of those crosses and keep it. I love to have, like, and I'm sorry, Lindsay, my wife, Lindsay, I'm sorry. I tend to be a pack, I collect things. I can't get rid of things. I have boxes of wires in my attic because one day I'll need them. I love mementos. I love milestones. And so we have these crosses for you as a milestone to say, this is the day that I let Jesus have the last word for me. To let his victory over death be my victory. And so if that's you today, you can take one of those crosses. But I want to invite Pastor Cameron to come up and lead us into communion.
Let us pray. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you, God, that indeed you have the last word. And God, we thank you that you have arisen. Christ has risen indeed. And so, Father, I pray, God, that wherever we come into this place, God, with whatever burden, whatever feeling or anything within our hearts, God, that we are going through, help us to know, God, that it is not the end of the story, that indeed you have the last word, and you call us to a life of hope and a life of peace through your son, Jesus. And so, Father, I pray, God, that as you consecrate this element, and as we eat of your body and drink of your blood, Lord, that we will receive your grace, God, to live resurrection life well within our context. And Father, I pray for those who may be making the decision to follow you this day. Father, be with them and help them, God, on their path. I pray all this in your most loving and kind name. Amen. Come and receive these gifts of God with gladness in your heart.
Gluten-free elements, by the way.
Stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. One final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the storm was rolled away, his perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever he is glorified.
sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah.
Yeah.
We sing hallelujah. The Woo. Lamb has overcome.
We sing
time forever.
Martin Luther King Jr. once said, to truly be free, you have to overcome the love of wealth and the fear of death. When you see the power that exudes from those who no longer fear death, who no longer walk around with the back of their mind thinking, what do I have to do? What do I have to do to survive? What do I have to do to make my mark? What do I have to do to matter and mean something? Jesus, in his last word, in his resurrection, defeats all of that. And those of us who choose to put our faith and trust in him, we are empowered to live a life of freedom. Not just one where we put on a nice face on Sunday mornings, not one where we just get to learn some nice things and be inspired by the life of a powerful teacher, rather, in seeing and finding Jesus as our Savior, as we see that his death on the cross paid for our sins and his resurrection is a deposit, a promise of our future with God. When we have faith in Jesus, his last word over us is one of life and life to the full. That's what he told his followers. He said, I came to bring life and life to the full. And it's available because he got the last word. And so again, if you walked into this room and you were on the fence about God or you weren't sure where you are, my prayer for you is that you'll look to an empty cross and recognize that the man who was hung there did that for you. And that is the empty tomb is now a promise that you and I can share in. And that you can have this new life. And you can let this last word of Jesus be something that frames the rest of your life, that frames how you live and how you think and how you operate, how you treat other people and how you relate to God. He gets the last word, and the last word is love. God loves you. He has plans and purposes for you. And it's not that you would die and be buried and gone, but that you would have life with him forever. And that's my hope for you today. Go in his grace and his peace today. We are so glad that you came today. It's very grateful, but you're dismissed. We love you.